Hello and welcome to Sports Opinion, the weekly sports talk show on Channel 18. That is Public Access TV. My name's Dirk Keller. Earl Murphy's over here, and we've got some very special guests, as has been tradition for the last 5 years. The Regina head football coach, Marv Cook, is here with some of his seniors to celebrate another state championship. This time, five in a row. The drive for five. Congratulations.
Thank you. I appreciate it. It's been a great season, obviously. Great group of seniors that led the team and really took on a lot of different challenges for us throughout the season and ended it with a great victory over a West Lyon team.
It looked like a very good West Lyon team. When the game started, seeing that they were seventh ranked and seeing what you had done to the second ranked team, South Winneshiek, I thought this would just be another 40-point rolling clock, but they stood up and took shot after shot from you guys.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. My son Drew is familiar with one of the players, Jacob Newborg, commit to Iowa, and this team has wanted to play us. I mean, from the time they moved from Class A to Class 1A, and they knew they were moving up, they were looking forward to the opportunity of matching up with these guys, and I respected that. I thought that was a sign that they really are proud of what they're doing and what they're trying to accomplish. And we always talk about, if you want to be great, you got to challenge yourself and put yourself in positions where you're going to find out how good you are. And so I think our kids knew it was going to be a great challenge. And to watch, you know, and these guys right here are three of the big reasons. They were lined up in the box where the games truly are won and lost. And they answered the bell and played at a very, very high level for us.
Well, we're going to introduce these guys. First, if you're watching on TV, to your far left is Zach Fackler. Next to him is Luke Gallagher. And then, of course, Michael Adam is here to join us. All three seniors, right?
Yep.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Have you got any... I've been approached by any other university or... You go next.
Yeah, what are your plans? What are your plans after high school? Luke, or Zach, I'm sorry.
I'm not sure what I'm going to do after high school. Hopefully attend like a four-year university. Not sure where yet.
And you've got basketball yet
yeah.
to play.
Mm-hmm.
When does practice start?
It already has, yeah. but we get like a week off. So.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Zach comes from a long line of athletes. Your sister, what? Yeah, what, Megan?
Megan, yeah.
Yeah, and where is she playing these days?
She's just up at UNI.
Come on in, guys. We had to start early because Marv is in a hurry. So unbuckle your coats.
I'm difficult.
Yeah.
Not at all. We're glad to have you here.
Sure are.
So what's Megan doing these days?
She's up at UNI. She's a sophomore this year.
Is she playing basketball there?
No, she got offered to play at William Penn, but she decided
Hey, Bud, can you give Bob a hand over? We're going to put you guys right behind us, one on each side.
All right, good.
Hang on, Bob. Bud will get you over there.
All right.
Bob and Bud, we've got Zach Fackler, Luke Gallagher, and Michael Adam here with Marv.
Well, hi, guys.
How you doing?
Bob Boyd is back.
We're back here.
Thanks for having us back. I appreciate it.
And Bud Simo's here.
You want me back here?
Perfect.
Yeah, right there.
Perfect.
Yes, sir. All right.
Yeah. How's the view from back there, Bob?
It looks great. Oh. Yeah.
Just checking.
He's buying
Hi, Murph. Hey, Michael Adam, are you the one that lives on Rochester Avenue?
I am.
By God, that used to be my house, you know.
Really?
Yeah. Actually, sold that to your mom and dad.
Really?
And you were just a little whippersnapper, about like that.
Yeah.
Any buried treasure left behind at the
No, no buried treasure there, Michael.
Okay. Yeah. For you Regals, these are a couple of Regina's biggest, longest supporters. Bud Supel has been to most of your games, not just this year, but every year. And he's a real Regal fan.
Well, and I offered to be Marv's offensive coordinator, but he didn't think that'd be a good idea.
How many fingers?
Four.
I watch it. Okay, so the West Lyon. Let's get back to the West Lyon game. It was kind of a smack each other in the jaw first half, and then the second half starts, and Jake Brinkman has a record-setting, a state title game record-setting 94-yard kickoff return. I thought that was lights out right there. I think West Lyon just knew they can't stand toe-to-toe with you guys.
This senior class, like I said, is one of the best I've seen, deep and athletic. And Jake Brinkman's a big-time player for us, and he's made big-time plays all season long. So obviously that was a huge play for us, the first play of the game with the flea flicker. I mean, it was a game of big plays, and we made more than West Lyon did. But other than that, I mean, the yardage was pretty much equal. The time of possession favored them. And I mean, it was a championship game, and I think our players – you know, walk off the field knowing that they had to go earn it. It wasn't going to be given to them. And that's a rewarding thing. That's a rewarding aspect of playing the game, and that's what you want in a championship game.
Guys, you've been together for, all three of you. Did you start at Regina as kindergartners?
No, I came in seventh grade.
Seventh grade?
But, yeah. I started at kindergarten.
Kindergarten?
Kindergarten.
So as a group, you've been together quite a long time.
Yeah.
And as high school players, you've tasted defeat once. That was at Solon to start the season, the 3A powerhouse. There's no shame in losing that game, but what did you learn from that experience to open the season?
I think one of the biggest things that we learned is just that we were nowhere near good enough. We weren't playing at a level that we needed to be to win a championship.
Yeah, and along with what Michael said, I just think it was a huge lesson. I think that we learned a lot from that defeat, and we just went on a roll and started working a lot harder and doing a lot of things different in practice. So.
Zach, did it change your focus?
Yeah.
Losing at Solon?
Yeah, a whole bunch. That next film session wasn't too good for me and Gallagher. You can ask Coach Dumont about that if you'd like. But that film session actually helped us a lot, even though we got our butts chewed for it. It helped us focus in for the next games. Cascade was our next week. And
no slouch of a team either.
No, they were really good, yeah. But it helped us focus in on what we needed to get done.
Was that game at Cascade?
No,
that was here.
It was at Regina. And I think Cascade came in ranked seventh in 2A when you played them.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
That's exactly
right. Mm-hmm. My eighth grade son was pretty downhearted after that loss at Solon. He was there. And I tried to tell him, look, first game of the year, if you're going to lose one, lose it now and build upon that. And that's exactly what you guys appeared to have done. Because, as you said, Cascade next game, tough opponent, had the 40-point rule in play. That was a heck of a game right there, and a statement, too, I think, about your fortitude. It's not easy for a lot of teams to get up off the mat after you've been knocked down, especially in such a thrilling overtime fashion as that Solon game. And I think the rest of the season is a real testament to what you're able to accomplish, not only what you were able to accomplish, but what you were able to overcome with that first loss. First loss in 57 games, mind you.
I'll jump in here real
yeah.
quick. I think the thing that really strikes me with this group is, you know, this is a group of guys that is freshmen, played Bettendorf. We went down to Bettendorf and played against their freshman team. You know, they lined up and played against Williamsburg when they were 3A and 2A and Fresoff and JV. And when we were talking about setting up a schedule for these guys, I mean, they wanted to see how good they were. They wanted to, basically put the title on the line and the record and all that stuff. They weren't afraid of being challenged, and they wanted – you know, that great rivalry we have with Solon. I think the last eight games is 4-4. So, I mean, they're great gates for the school that hosts them. So, you know, those are the types of things that I think make high school athletics great. Xavier was gracious enough to accept a home and home with us, and to go up there and play in that atmosphere. It was phenomenal. It was a great night of high school football, obviously, for us. And, you know, the crowds were huge. You look mm-hmm. in our stands were full. The sidelines were full. These guys have answered every challenge we've thrown at them, and they've done it with class and dignity. And you know, they talk about Solon, the game was on me. I mean, I did a poor job coaching and made about four or five mistakes from a coaching standpoint that didn't put our kids in positions to be successful, and that's my fault. And I learned from that as a coach, too. So, I couldn't be prouder of the way these guys have just, carried themselves not so much on the football field, because I've always been proud of that, but just the way they carry themselves off the football field. They're great young men. They're going to be extremely successful in whatever they choose to do in life, and that's what makes me excited as a coach.
Well, that brings me to another point. Yesterday at lunch, you spoke to our small gathering, and you talked about these kids. I mean, your son, Drew, is a part of this class, and you've coached them since they were peewees, and you said yesterday, well, you said something at lunch I'd like you to repeat about, it's not what they've accomplished now, but if you want to finish.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, one of the messages we always try to give them is this is a great deal. I mean, winning a state championship and doing it multiple times. Mike, this is Mike's third as a starter for Regina. This is Luke's second and Zach's second, basically. You know, and some of our kids, this is their first. So, you know, we want this to be a big thing in their life, but ultimately as life goes on, we want this to become smaller and smaller as far as what defines them and the person they are, and ultimately want them to take the characteristics and the lessons of what it takes to be successful. Because I'm telling you what, it's been a grind. I mean, it's been a 3-year commitment, 4-year commitment from these guys, actually even longer than that, junior high, of dedication, hard work, discipline, you know, being a great teammate, all that stuff, to make this happen. And if they can take those same characteristics on into college or to a vocation, whether it's education, agriculture, medicine, or whatever, I have no doubt that they're going to be extremely successful. And ultimately, when people look at me and say, how good a coach have we been as coaches at Regina, me and our staff, it's going to come down to how these guys are 15, 20 years from now, how successful they are, how good of, you know, parents, fathers they are. And that's ultimately what we're going to be evaluated on, I think.
That's a heck of a statement, guys. It ain't over. You got a lot of living up to do to meet your coach's expectations.
I think it's important also to note that, you know, Marv's pretty modest, but, you know, these kids have also seen great leadership and a great example to follow, not just in Marv, but the other coaches and their commitment. And that's a huge part of this. And they all know that. They've seen it every day. But, you know, what a record you've established. I mean, Marv, I'm not too happy about your 5 losses. We might want to talk about
They're
that.
Six.
It's six, yeah.
Oh, is it six? Oh, well, geez, you know, it's just an awful record.
Thanks for bringing it up.
106.
In case you didn't hear Bob, Marv's overall record as head coach at Regina is 100 wins, correct? Bob knows probably better than Marv.
100 wins and 6 losses.
And 6 losses. Not bad over 8 seasons.
8 seasons, yeah.
Not bad. Well, Bob, that's a real good point. And, guys, one of the things I wanted to ask you to talk about, too, is the assistant coaches. You've got a stable of pretty impressive coaches. And let me just tell you, before I let you talk about your assistants, as a fan, from my perspective, and I think I speak for Bud and Earl and Bob, when we go to watch your games, home or away, it's real evident early on that it's not just – your performance on the field, it's the coaching. There are situations in most every game, especially the, you know, closer games against the more competitive teams, where there's a moment in that game, and I can think of several just this year, where the coaching all of a sudden, boom, makes a difference. I can't remember the home game, but I think the score at the end of the first quarter was tied, 7-7.
14-14.
It wasn't a playoff game, though. It was earlier in the season. And then the coaching took over. Talk a little bit about the coaches and what they've meant to you as well, what they've added to the mix. Go ahead, Zach.
Well, we're just really blessed, I guess, to have this coaching staff. There's a lot of guys that know what they're doing. I spent most of my time with Coach Brinkman, our D-line coach. And he's really helped me through this season. He's made me a better player, better person.
Good deal.
I think that we really don't keep the same defense throughout the whole week into the game. Like, we'll make some changes, like, right after the game starts or at game time. And I think Coach Juman especially is really good at that because, I mean, he works on what defense we're going to run all week. And then right when the game starts or right when something happens, he knows exactly what's going on right then. So,
yeah, I think that Dumont plays a huge role in knowing and getting each of us exactly where we need to go.
Tell the viewers what Coach Dumont does. What are his duties as assistant?
Oh, what doesn't he do? I mean, even in the off season, he's working on the field. He's putting in countless hours, just making everything look nice, making the game field look nice, making the practice field look nice. keeping up all the facilities. I mean, he does a great job with everything. He, I've had the privilege of working with him for 3 years, and I mean, after that 3 years, he's really known. I mean, he's gotten a lot better at working with me and Jake. And I mean, when we mess up in a game, all we need to do is come off to the sideline. He looks at us, and when he looks at you like that, you know you messed up.
Former Hawkeye football player under Hayden Fry, yeah. Jason Dumont. Who are some of the other coaches? Tell us, tell the viewers who they are, what they do.
Coach Hinkle. Or,
Ed Hinkle, former wide receiver.
Yep. Coach Brinkman, like I said, went to UNI. Coach Stout, he's the DVAC coordinator.
Played at St. Ambrose.
Coach, yeah.
Anybody else we're forgetting, Marv?
Coach Canales, who played
then
at
Iowa. Then there's Alex Canales, former Hawkeye, former West High star.
And then wide receiver coach Tom Nosbusch, coach mm-hmm. Coach Cook when he was in high school.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yep. I'll be darned. So Alex Canales, let's talk a little bit about your strength and speed training coach. Go ahead, Zach.
Well, strength and speed has helped us a lot in winning these championships. I think it's probably the number one thing that comes to mind when you think about that.
In watching your semifinal game against South Winneshiek, I thought that was clearly the difference in the game was the strength of the line. Mm-hmm. That was South Winneshiek was ranked number two in the state, mm-hmm. and they had some big boys, but I don't think they had the stamina, did they?
You know, Coach Canales puts in a lot of time and effort, and he's always in the weight room with us, you know, 5 a.m., early in the mornings, and I just think the time and effort he puts in, we have a tremendous privilege to have that, and I think that he does a great job. So,
well, I think that West line was a dream game for Coach Canales because they run a smash mouth offense, yep. And there's nothing that gets Canales more excited than having one of his linemen go up against Jake Newborg.
Jake Newborg is a future Hawkeye lineman. Is he going to be defense or offense?
I don't know.
Yeah. He went both ways. He played both ways, yeah, in the championship game.
Yeah, I think they had him listed at 6'3", 280. That sound right, Mark?
Yeah, that's about right. I mean, he's a thick.
He's not a small guy.
Yeah.
Did he? You guys had to go up against him?
Yeah.
Huh?
Mm-hmm. Comes off the ball. You know, I think the thing that, you know, all our staff, you know, I think they're all head coaches. I try to give them as much autonomy as possible because I truly believe that they are all brilliant. They're incredibly talented at what they do, teaching. You know, first and foremost, they're great mentors. They're great men, great family men, and great mentors to these guys. And so, and then you add to the fact that they're just phenomenal football teachers. You know, I truly give them, you know, the ability to coach their positions and let them do what they need to do. The thing that I'll say, like, about our defense that I love is, you know, I mentioned it yesterday. If you're going into a championship fight and you got a right-handed puncher, you know, Coach Dumont and that staff is going to make you fight left-handed just because they're brilliant with what they do. They communicate with their athletes extremely well, and they're going to take away the things that you're comfortable doing. And I just it's incredible. The one thing that I would say is I would never, ever want to have to coach against him. I mean, those guys are brilliant, and Coach Henkel's doing a phenomenal job offensively as well.
Joe's pointing at his watch as if it might be time for
I think
for,
I've got to go.
You got to go.
All right. I'm so glad that these three guys are here because, you know, for those who don't know, we're blessed at Regina. The other thing I was going to mention is I think 97% of the students at Regina participate in some form of athletics, and that's why it's so important to have a guy like Alex Canales on staff with these guys. But these, I'm glad you get a platform with these three guys because they are truly great representatives of what's great about Regina, Regina football, Regina athletics, and just about our Regina community as a whole.
Well, Marv, before you go, I'm just going to say I'm going to turn that around a little bit.
Well, one of them was supposed to bring the trophy, but I'm not going to throw the guy under the bus. So.
We won't go there. Marv, you've been a wonderful representative for not just the school, but really for the entire city. You make us really proud to send our kids to Regina. I know that I can speak for Bud and Earl and Bob as Regina grads, or at least the predecessors of Regina, St. Mary's graduates, that you make all of them proud as well. We've been around long enough to remember when the Regina football program was lucky to win a couple of games a year. and that's turned around. And I know it didn't start with you, but what you did was you carried the torch, and you continue to do that after 8 years, and you've not only brought pride back to the school and the alumni, and brought winning back to the program, but you're also developing fine young men, and you're bringing fine young men in to coach too. So thank you for that on behalf of my son and me and everyone else in here. It's been a real honor to see this season go down. Record-setting fifth straight state title for Marv Cook and his staff. And Marv's got to take off. It's holiday time. Marv, we want to wish you a very happy Thanksgiving.
Thank you very much.
Mom's doing all right?
She is. She's had a little scare here just after the game. She had to check into the hospital for a couple days to get her fluids back up. She's was a little dehydrated, yeah. But she's doing okay.
She's a wonderful woman, yeah. And it's an honor to know her, too. So
yeah, thank you.
Good luck from here on out. Bud's got one question before you go.
Take that arrangement on the table.
Okay.
Then I got one thing I'd like you to sign. You don't have to write here. You can look it over.
Okay.
Let's look it over.
Okay, I got it. Wait. I won't read it. I just want to see it.
Is that a new contract?
Yeah.
Regina.
Go get her AD to sign off on
that. Marv went out of his way to be here today. He's got a lot going on, and we really appreciate it, and really appreciate everything you've done. So thanks.
You bet. No, thank you. Like I said, if nothing else, I'm glad that these guys are going to get the platform, because you know people will hopefully get a really good glimpse of what makes Regina so special. So thank you.
You're welcome. Happy Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving, Marv.
Best to your family.
Oh, I appreciate that. Thanks.
You go right ahead.
Yep.
I'm going to just move over here. Okay, guys.
Yeah.
Now, one of the things that it goes on behind the scenes during the summer, we talked about strength and conditioning coaches. One of the little bonuses of going to school at Regina is that former Hawkeyes, both football, basketball, men's and women's players, are out there lifting weights with you guys every day. The last 2 years, current Hawkeye running back Mark Weissman has been in there. And Mark's not just any Hawkeye or any running back. This guy is a workout beast. And I'm sure you guys have seen his high school workout videos on YouTube. It's just unbelievable what he put himself through. And yet I saw him working with my son the last two summers. And he has such a way with young kids. And I'd like to have you talk a little bit about your experience with Mark Weissman and any other Hawkeyes who are in the weight room during the summer with you.
One of the great things about going to Regina is that you get the privilege to work with a lot of, amazing athletes like Mark Weissman and Adrian Claiborne and Coach Canales. And, that presents us with so many more opportunities than it would if, you never had those people around to lift with you over the summer. I think they really keep the drive going in your heart whenever you're not feeling like lifting, but you want to go there anyways just to be with them.
Yeah, that's great, Michael. What do you think, Luke?
Yeah, Mike pretty much said it all, but it's a pretty big privilege to be able to lift those guys, and not only Mark Weissman, but along with, even women's basketball players get in there. There's Jamie Prinney was in there, Camille Walling.
She's now the head coach at Linmar, girls basketball.
Yeah.
Yeah, so a bunch of different figures come in and lift with us. Well, as long as I've been there. Since.
And it's a lifting program and speed training, not just for boys, but for girls, too. I don't know if that's unique. The weight room's pretty small, and I think it's just really special that the boys and girls work alongside each other with younger men and women like the Hawkeye athletes you've mentioned. Talk a little bit about Mark Weissman, though, and his personality and what sets him apart in the weight room.
Well, he's in there. He was in there a lot this summer, and last year it was a lot different. But after 1 year with him, everyone got to know him a lot better, and I think he got more comfortable with the program and with the kids that he was working with. And I think this year was a lot different than last year.
Mm-hmm. What do you think, Zach?
I think that having people like Mark Weissman there is a good motivation for more kids to come in and want to lift. And maybe after coming in for the first time lifting, they're like, hey, this could probably actually help me out. And they just keep lifting and keep going even after Mark Weissman or Adrian Claiborne or Jamie Prenti leave to go back to college. And it's just good motivation for kids, I think.
You're out there in the summer every morning. What time, roughly?
Well, the good thing about having people like Coach Canales is that if you need to lift and you need to be flexible with it, I mean, he'll let you come in any time that you need to. You can come in any time from 5 till 6.
5 a.m.?
Yep, 5 in the morning till 6 at night.
That's something.
He's there pretty much all day. He takes a lunch break, but yeah. There's like in the summer we have scheduled time slots that there's open lifts and then there's scheduled lifts for boys or girls or junior high kids or high school kids. So,
when do they start with a weight program? Is it junior high primarily?
Oh, no. Paul started 5th grade.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
6th grade.
And I think, yeah.
Didn't know that.
Canales really caters the workouts to whatever age group it needs to be. So high school boys, I mean, we're doing pretty heavy weights. 6th grade boys are doing PVC pipes, working on their squat form, and just so that they can get ready for high school.
I'd pick my son up early in the morning after his 3 days a week workout, about 7 or 7:30, I can't remember, I think it varied. And I'd see you guys out there in the parking lot with that weighted sled, pushing and pulling that weighted sled around. Did you come to hate the sled? What do you think, Zach?
I actually like the sled a lot.
Yeah?
Even though it was probably a little painful sometimes, there's always that thought in your mind that this is going to get me better, this is going to help me win a state championship.
You guys aren't old enough to remember when your coach played for the Hawkeyes, but I am. And I can remember distinctly one day sitting in traffic, stopped at a stoplight on Riverside Drive, not just down the hill from Hillcrest Dormitory, and sitting across from me at the stoplight was this great big hulking guy with this blazing mohawk haircut on a little tiny mini bike. I looked and I looked, I said, what is that? It's Alex Canales on his way to class. And it's just a shame because he had a tremendous high school career, but in college, and I think maybe in high school too, he had concussions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Have you guys had any injury issues like that?
I've had one concussion personally, and it's pretty scary.
When did that happen?
I was actually playing soccer when it happened. And
really?
So I took an elbow to the to the temple, and I was out for the count.
You knew right away?
Yeah, I knew.
Wow. Guys?
Are you going out for soccer this year?
I am.
Good.
Oh, yeah.
Good.
Regina's got a tremendous soccer
Do.
History. And who's the soccer coach?
Rick LaRue.
Rick LaRue. He's been there a long time.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Rick LaRue.
Dr. Rick LaRue.
Yeah. He's started the program, didn't he, Michael?
Yep.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about Coach LaRue.
He's an amazing, very unique character. From all the soccer coaches I've had, I've been playing since I was a peewee. He's got a very unique style of coaching, but I mean, he's very successful with it. I think all of his players really respect him for that, and he's really sort of pioneered the way of soccer coaching.
With several state championships also. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
how many do you have?
I have 2 in soccer.
Wow.
But how many does Dr. LaRue have?
He has...
It's 4 out of the last 5 years.
4 out of the last 5 years.
Four.
We need to have Dr. Rick LaRue out, guys. Yeah.
That's not a bad idea.
Soccer season starts.
No kidding. So
he's my doctor, and I had a bad stroke, and he went to my wife and told her not to expect the best.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what she got. I'm sorry. Joe, sorry.
That's Bionic Girl over there.
That's right.
And
91 years strong.
Yeah. That's right.
And
Dr. LaRue got you through that.
Yes.
Was that the first or second stroke?
It was the first.
First one. Wow. Man. So, basketball.
I just like to talk about your coach. He's the finest person I've ever met.
You talking about Dr. LaRue?
No.
Mr. Cook.
Mr. Cook.
Marv Cook.
Yeah. Marv Cook.
Yeah, we're big fans of Marv, and now that he's gone, we can talk a little bit about him. Go ahead, Earl.
I would just like to say that I was a friend of his when he was playing for Iowa, and I was certainly a fan of his when he was coaching Regina. And I had a lot of confidence in him, and I can see why he's got that huge figure of 100 wins And we won't count the losses. They're minimal.
Does anybody ever give Coach Cook a hard time about never smiling on the sideline?
Yeah.
He talked about it a little. So.
Yeah.
I wasn't able to go to either the semifinal or the championship game, but I watched on TV the whole thing, and it was pretty funny. Whenever the cameras would come on, no smile. Even at the end of the championship game, when his little son, I'm drawing a blank on his name.
Ashton
was on the field there with him, and Ashton had the war paint all over his face, and Marv was just kind of looking at it, kind of, you know, turning his cheek around, and no smile.
What is Ashton, fifth, sixth grade?
He's a sixth grader.
Sixth grader, okay.
Yeah.
You know, that brings up a question I've always wondered, and that's Drew Cook. How far can he throw a football?
I've never seen him max it out, but he can throw the ball 60 yards with ease.
Is that right?
Yeah. Perfect spiral on point within 3 yards.
Wow. Well, he threw a, wasn't it, the opening play for you guys in a championship game was a double reverse flea flicker.
Yep.
That was just 47 yards.
Yeah.
But in the semifinal, didn't he throw a,
he threw
a 60 yard bomb?
Stinger.
Yeah, to Stinger.
Stinger had three touchdowns.
He can throw the ball. Yeah.
So who called that double reverse flea flicker to open play?
I'm sure it's Hinkle.
Was it?
Yeah.
So Coach Ed Hinkle, former Hawkeye wide receiver under Kirk Ferentz, is the offensive coordinator, basically, right?
Yep.
And who coordinates the defensive side?
Coach Dumont.
Coach Dumont. Coach Prank.
Jason
Coach
Dumont, former Hayden Fry disciple. You talk about your coaching trees. It's pretty amazing what's going on. And I'm sure you guys realize this, but when you've played a lot of teams this year at home in the regular season, last year, throughout your high school career, who had to travel a great distance. And in the playoffs, it was just ridiculous how far some of these teams had to come.
Yeah.
For what they knew was going to happen. And yet they came and packed those visitor stands. And one of the primary reasons was Coach Cook. They want to see him. You've been playing for a living legend, and several of them. Ed Hinkle was legendary when he played for the Hawkeyes. Jason Dumont, Hayden Fry used to talk about him all the time, his hard-nosed, tough play. I believe Jason was a linebacker for the Hawkeyes. Am I right?
No.
Was he a defensive lineman?
Defensive lineman.
Yeah. But they come to see these guys.
They come to see you, but you've got a special attraction in your coaching staff. And...
Well, the combination of was a pretty big attraction.
And well, go ahead, Bob.
I was going to ask you, in your last couple of years, what was your toughest game? I mean, I realize you lost to Solon, but was that really the toughest game to win in the last couple of years that you guys have been involved?
Man, that's a good question. I think
Xavier was a tough one.
I think Xavier was probably our most mentally and physically tough game.
Which you won 21-7.
It was, I mean, the score showed a lot bigger difference than the game did.
Yeah.
I mean, that game was...
It was a tight game late in the third quarter, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
Solon wasn't bad.
Yeah.
Solon was definitely a hard game, but I think a lot of it was just being the first game. Yeah. We had no idea what was coming for us. I mean, we didn't really change up our offense a whole lot, but I think that they made it. Minor tweaks of theirs then.
So when you found out that Cedar Rapids Xavier was on your schedule this year, what was your first thought, Zach?
I was excited.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Good.
I knew our coaches have been trying to get Xavier on the schedule for a few years, and now that they accepted our request.
What did you think, Luke?
Actually, last year when we found out, we were in class, and we came out in the hallways, and I mean, people started talking about it right away. Everyone came out to me, did you see the schedule? And first thing was Xavier's week 8, so everyone was pretty excited about that.
Yeah.
I was ecstatic.
Yeah.
We going into that game, we knew we had nothing to lose. We were a 1A team, and the streak was already gone. Not that it meant a whole lot to begin with, but we had absolutely nothing to lose, and I loved it.
You don't ever get to play other Catholic schools unless it's in the playoffs.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And here you've got this monster school just 30 miles north that you've never played, that Regina's never played.
And that had just dropped down from 4A also.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the biggest.
I mean, they've got an enrollment that I'm going to guess is 5-6 times greater than Regina.
Oh, I don't think so.
I don't know.
They dropped down to 3A.
But that they'd always been 3A. They just enrollment-wise, but they played.
Oh no,
they
were 4A at one time when they opened up.
They were that large.
Okay, yeah.
Well, what a big victory, that's for sure. Now, when you looked at the season, okay, I realize the cliche thing to say, and your coach tells you, is we just worry about the next game. You know, that's what we're practicing for. But did you guys, through the season, think we got to get that fifth title? That was your goal? I mean, did you look beyond that next game philosophy?
Now you can talk.
Yeah, the season's over now, guys.
Well, I think the goal was always to extend the streak to 70, first and foremost, the goal was to get 5 straight titles, yes. Whether or not we lost to Xavier, whether or not we lost to Solon. We wanted to win all the district games, we wanted to win all the playoff games, and that was the number one goal. But second to that was definitely beat Xavier and beat Solon.
Let me ask you this, you're seniors, so you know what's coming behind you. Does Regina have a good shot at a sixth with the talent coming up?
Yeah, they got some good talent, and a lot of those kids are really hardworking, and I think that they'll put a lot of time and effort into the off season. So it'll be interesting to see.
Yeah.
The next season.
Will it be as many guys out?
I don't know. We have our senior class is pretty big with about 22 kids.
Wow.
So I think. It'll be a little
football
bit smaller.
Players own. Yeah. I think Marv said yesterday at lunch the junior, sophomore, and freshman classes average around 12, 13, 14 mm-hmm. kids out for football. Yep. Does that sound right?
Yeah. That's pretty good.
Yeah. I know my son's eighth grade team just had 13 kids.
But how did the sophomores do? Did they have a pretty good season?
Well, they were headed by Coach Canellis, and he just had a blast coaching them. I mean, him and Hinkle are all about the trick plays. They love them. Statue of Liberty, flea flickers. I mean, Canellis really enjoyed doing that. I think they won all of their games.
The only game they lost was Xavier.
They did lose.
Yeah, they lost.
They played right before us.
Oh, okay.
But it was a dog fight.
They played West High. They beat West High.
I can tell you an Iowa story. I recruited for the Hawkeyes.
Yeah,
I went to New York with Hayden Fry and stuff. You know, but Randy Duncan was a good friend of mine, and he was the captain of the team and
former quarterback.
And he said, we're going to have a trick play Saturday. It's the 58 team. They went to the Rose Bowl.
And won.
And won. And he said, when they were playing Purdue. And when Purdue punts, DeBrino catches the ball and put his hand back and have the ball in it. And Earl Smith will get it and go around in and make a long game. It happened. My wife and I were sitting there, and I said, "My God, this is perfect." Purdue punted the ball, and DeBrino caught it and put his hand back, had the ball in it, and Smith took it and went 50 yards for a TD.
That's trick plays.
Trick plays and stuff like that. You know, I'm. And I had the access.
Yep. Go ahead, Merle. Earl. Go ahead. Okay.
But anyhow, that was a trick play, and Randy Duncan. I thought about it. I was with him Saturday at the game, and he has had a bad heart attack.
Is he doing all right?
He's a lot better.
Good.
I'm gonna
mention a couple of highlights of these kids. You know, I opened up the paper Monday of this week, and I saw the All-State selections for all classes. Regina had 7 All-Staters in the 1A class, and I'm gonna read them off. First off, Drew Cook, first-team All-State captain, threw for 2,504 yards. 31 touchdowns. That's just this season. He rushed for 706 yards and 16 touchdowns, and he even caught a touchdown pass in the state title game. Who called that play? Was that Hinkle?
I think so. Stanger and Drew were working on fades all week at practice, and I think they were just prepared for that, and Hinkle decided to make the call.
I don't think most people noticed that Drew wasn't under center on that play. Yeah. And
Westline certainly did.
They
were yelling Wildcat the whole.
They knew. And there was nothing they could do about it. The throw was perfectly placed in the corner of the end zone, and Drew was the only one that could have gone up with his height and grabbed that thing.
Yeah, Stanger made a big time play there.
And that wasn't his only touchdown this year or last year. Was there another one thrown to him in the playoffs?
We've had that play put in for quite a while, but we've always it's always sort of been up for juggle who's going to throw it. Luke threw one against Wes Marshall.
I attempted to throw one to him, but
I remember that. That was you.
Yeah.
Now, do you guys draw straws to get to see who throws the?
I was just throwing in practice, and Coach Cook asked me to throw one to Drew, and I threw a couple to him, and so he gave me the opportunity in the game, and unfortunately, I didn't get it quite there. But
well, Drew's not here to defend himself, so let's talk a little bit about Drew. I was hoping he'd be here today, but I know he's busy. Tell us about Drew Cook, Zach. You've been with him since first grade, or kindergarten, I think, for that matter.
Drew's a great guy. Every time you see him in the hallway, he'll say, hey, what's up, ask how you're doing. And he's just got a great personality, makes a lot of friends with everyone, loves him at school, so, yeah.
And what kind of basketball teammate is he?
Very good teammate. He'll push you till you're at your best ability.
Luke?
Drew's very humble. He will not talk about himself a lot, but he's just a great kid, and I think he's going to do big things at Iowa, so I'm looking forward to it.
You know, a lot of people, you mentioned Drew Cook is going to be, has already agreed to play football for Iowa as quarterback. A lot of people doubt that he's going to stay at quarterback during his college career, and I don't know what you guys think, and I want to find out what you think, but I know watching in the playoffs, I saw a college quarterback. What do you guys, tell me, what do you think?
Well, I think one of the reasons that people doubt that he would stay at quarterback is because of the way that he can catch, like he showed in the championship game. He just tears up our defense when it's time to practice defensive 7-on-7, and he goes out for a receiver, and Stanger goes back at quarterback, and we always end up having to put two guys on him. And, I mean, he still makes the one-handed snags, and he's fast.
He's fast.
He's physical.
He's an all-around athlete.
Yeah.
Did you guys play against a quarterback with that kind of speed this year?
We actually played against a kid from, where was that kid from?
What number?
Number 7. From,
was it number 7 was our second playoff.
Panora.
Yeah, Panora.
Not that.
He was, that big kid.
Quarterfinal.
Right?
Yeah.
He was their leading passer, leading rusher.
Yeah.
He was
the punter.
The kicker.
He's just a sophomore.
Yeah.
And that
kid
got kicked out.
He's like 200.
Yeah, that was a quarterfinal game. That wasn't Panorama.
Yeah.
What school was that?
Was that Central Decatur, I believe.
Yeah, Central Decatur. Okay. That's it.
What did that – okay. And we were there, and we saw him get in a scuffle. Who did he get in a fight with?
Peyton Mosk.
Yes. So then his teammate comes out.
Yeah.
And body slams him.
Yeah.
And I've read since that both those kids are pretty strong wrestlers. So what did you guys think? You're out there. You see a teammate pick up his quarterback, his star, and body slam him. What did you think when you see that?
Well, I sort of saw it coming the entire game. I mean, the game was pretty chippy. We were both fighting for the chance to the dome. And, obviously frustration is high when you're down by however many points. And, I mean, it was kind of refreshing to see his teammate pick him up and take him off our own guy.
Yeah. I talked to some of your coaches after the game, and they said, yeah, like you did. It was a little chippy, and this kid in particular had been doing a lot of chirping throughout the game. I think one of the most touching moments afterwards was when the opponent's coach called timeout with just a few seconds left in the game and made his quarterback go across the field and shake hands and apologize with the Regina coaches.
Absolutely.
I'd never seen anything like that before.
That's pretty classy.
That was classy. Yeah. And that was which team?
Central Decatur.
Central Decatur. Yeah. Thanks.
Where is Central Decatur?
Decatur County. It's Bud. Where is it? Bob, you know?
I think it's
in Iowa.
Yeah, no, it's
all I know.
Northeast.
It was like 100 and... Yeah.
Yeah.
I forget
it's
how many.
It's a long drive.
Yeah.
158.
They came from a long way.
Is it Leon, I think?
What are you guys, yes. What are your plans for next year individually?
Well, before next year,
yes.
Are you going out for basketball?
No, I play baseball.
Though. You're a baseball player. Mm-hmm.
He's thinking about going out for soccer.
Yeah?
They need a goalie, so he's trying to talk me into it.
Why not? Luke, what's after high school?
Well, depending on how senior year for baseball goes, I'm going to decide if I want to do that. But other than that, possibly Iowa, just for school.
And you've got a new baseball coach.
Yep, Jeff Pacia. Oh, Andy Gann retired last year, and that was pretty emotional after our last game with him retiring. And
you guys had a heck of a baseball season again.
Yeah, it was pretty special.
Yeah. So tell us about your new coach.
Jeff Pacia, he's been on the staff before, so he's been with us for a while, and we're all familiar with him.
He played baseball for Iowa?
Yep, and he played at Regina as well. So I think it'll be a pretty good year. I'm looking forward to working with him. So.
Very good. Michael, what are your plans after high school?
Well, I started looking at colleges in the summer, but unfortunately football season rolled around and there's not really a whole lot of time for anything other than football during football season. So now that it's the winter, I get a little bit of time to myself and to figure out what I want to do. So,
do you think you might want to compete in athletics in college?
I don't know at this point. Yeah. Maybe.
Maybe?
Maybe.
Luke's maybe on baseball in college?
We'll
Zach,
see.
What do you think?
I'm not sure where I'm going to go yet.
You got time.
Yeah.
You got time.
Still got some time to think.
Go ahead, Earl.
How much do you weigh?
Do I weigh?
Yeah.
195.
And how tall are you?
6'3".
6'3",
205. Is that 200 pound tackles? You're in. Which one's the new?
We're both defensive ends.
Okay, you're both defensive. Is that right?
Yeah, and I play tackle as well.
Okay.
We got some. I didn't finish talking about these All-State players. We have other Regals that were picked for the 1A first team. Nate Stenger, junior, right?
Yep.
He'll be the quarterback next year.
I think it's up for grabs.
Is it?
Yeah.
Who will he be competing with?
Michael Conlin, who's a freshman.
Gonna be a sophomore.
Freshman. He'll be a sophomore.
Okay.
And then Tommy Rapp is going into his junior year.
Okay.
But is that Bill Condon's relation?
No, but it's, do you remember the one that had the large family?
That's Bill Condon.
No, but I mean, yeah, Bill had a big one too. But this is, I can't think of his name, but it's one of the large families that's going to reach.
Okay. Lineman Phil Arndt, first team All-State. Linebacker Jake Brinkman, first team All-State.
Yeah, now, what year is he?
He's
senior.
Senior, that's
right. And kicker Jacob Adam, first team All-State. Jacob Adam, do you guys realize how fortunate you are to have a kicker in 1A who puts not only makes every – Jacob Adam only played football in high school 3 years, right?
Yes. Yeah, he came out his sophomore year.
Senior. He kicked, I think, 5 extra points his sophomore year and has never missed one, never missed an extra point. And he continually put kickoffs into the end zone, touchback, which is such a big deal.
Is he related to you, Michael?
He is.
First cousins?
Third or fourth.
Okay. He's really something special. I mean, I know you're old enough to remember Daniel Murray a little bit, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This kid, your third or fourth cousin, is just incredible with what he can accomplish. And he's one of your leading soccer players as well, right?
Mm-hmm.
What's his position in soccer?
Coach Rue moves us all around a lot, but Jake mainly plays center midfield.
Yeah, where he can score.
Yeah.
He's got a cannon. And I hope that Iowa, I hope that Kirk Ferentz is paying attention. Not that the kickers Iowa has now are bad, but somebody like this doesn't come along very often.
You guys, does he want to go to school?
I don't think he's decided yet.
No, okay.
He'll be kicking somewhere.
Has he had a lot of people, a lot of schools look at him? Or
yeah, he's had a few.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So then let's see here. We've got second team All-Staters. Linebacker Justin Hunter, who is a junior, and one Luke Gallagher, offensive lineman they call you here, but second team All-State. That's a heck of an accomplishment.
Thank you.
It's one thing to accomplish all these things as a team, five straight state titles, but the individual accolades mean something, Luke, and really proud of what you've been able to accomplish. It's just amazing to have seven first team or second team All-Staters at a 1A school. It's, again, as Coach Cook said, these accomplishments are going to get smaller and smaller in your rear view mirror. And he's set all of you up. I think he and his staff have set all of you up for even greater things. And it starts right now in high school when you learn how to accomplish the goals that he sets for you, that you set for your individual selves. And now, you know, we'll see what happens next. But the older you get, the smaller this accomplishment gets and the bigger the ones ahead of you become. So keep up the good work. Adam Martinson, he's the Regina wrestling coach, both junior high and high school. He coached my son in eighth grade this year. And I think he's somebody pretty special too, because I've seen it up close what he's done. What were his roles with you on the varsity these last few years?
Adam did a lot of special team stuff. He's definitely worked with our physicality, and he's come back with linebackers quite a bit. And he really teaches you a type of mentality to not give up, as wrestlers need.
That's right. That's a wrestling mentality. His eighth grade team this year only lost two games, one in a season opener downpour at Anamosa, and one to a very good Mid-Prairie team. What's Mid-Prairie? Are they 2A or 3A?
I think 2A.
They're 2A.
2A? Yeah. Last year, that same Regina team went to Mid-Prairie and got beat by 40-some points.
Ooh.
Outmanned, outgunned. This year, same 13 players on the 8th grade team. Had Mid-Prairie on the ropes, had them beat until the last second. I don't know, it was a 60 or 80-yard breakaway run that ended it. You guys did something last year. Yeah, I'm sure that y'all don't remember it, but you were having your varsity practice on the practice field out by the track, and the then seventh graders were playing again. It was a rough season, their seventh grade year. Two wins the whole season, and they had a goal line stand against, I forget who, a really good team. And you guys are just wrapping up practice, and as a group, you came to the south end of the field. Well, I'm sorry, north end of the field, nearest your practice field, and stood there and cheered these guys on. And they got fired up. You could see it. You guys stood there for that whole goal line stand, and they held their opponent out of the end zone. I think in no small part because of what you guys, the big guys, did for them, standing in that end zone, up against the fence and cheering them on. I know I talked to my son afterwards, and it meant a lot to him. And those are the little things that you get at a school like Regina. It's a small school. Everybody knows everybody. And it's, I don't know if you realize it, but those fifth, sixth, junior high kids, fifth, sixth graders, they look up to you, just like you probably did when you were that age. Yeah. So when you were junior high, who did you guys look up to there in the halls of Regina? Michael?
Well, one of the things that that's so great about having Coach Cook as a football coach is that not only does he teach us everything about football and all the concepts, but one of the ideas that he's really hammered home is do the little things for the little guys, and I mean, they'll remember it forever.
They do.
And even my freshman year when I was playing scout team defense against Jake Lehman, one of our
champions. Who's now playing for Northern Iowa.
Yeah. I mean, I remember him just after one of the plays, just talking to me and telling me, teaching me how to set the edge, because he was also an outside linebacker. And, I mean, I've always remembered that, and it's a great thing to be able to look up to a senior and have him t- talk to you.
And he probably doesn't remember that.
I'm sure he doesn't.
Luke? That's all that senior leadership that the Marv talks about all the time, too.
Right.
Senior leadership.
Yep. Yeah, and Coach Cook does put a lot of emphasis on us being leaders and role models to the younger kids, because he tells us all the time how much they look up to us and mm-hmm. how much that we probably help them. So.
You really do, whether you know it or not. They really admire you guys. And it's not just because you're winners on the field. It's the way you treat one another. They see that. They see that in the hallways every day. It's a small school, so you pretty much see everybody. Zach, who was who influenced you when you were a junior high or younger?
Well, our eighth grade year is when the whole streak thing started. And that was when one of my cousins was part of that team.
Who's that?
BJ Jensen.
Really?
Yep. So I got to know a lot of his friends, and I always looked up to them. And BJ, unfortunately, couldn't play this season or the whole season because of an unfortunate back injury.
Mm-hmm.
But as I was told, he was always still on the sidelines cheering people on, getting him better, and that's what I looked up to.
So. That's interesting. We're in the throes of the Thanksgiving holiday period, and I thought I'd ask these kids, we've got 5 minutes to go here before the show's over, and just thought I'd ask you each individually, what are you thankful for? Michael?
Well, just coming out of the football season, I'm thankful for another win. I mean, it's going to be something that I look back on and I'll think about probably every day of my life. I'm thankful for playing a team like Solon, who did beat us, because I mean, it really taught us how to lose, taught us how to be better, taught us how to take criticism from coaches. And I think that's one of the reasons that we won out.
Very well said, Michael. Wow. Luke?
Well, with what Michael said with the football aspect of things, I think I'm really thankful for the senior class and the guys I got to play with and got to know for the past 6 years. It's been a really big privilege, but other than that, I'm really thankful for my family and just my parents sending me to Regina in seventh grade and making that decision.
Where did you go to school before Regina?
Penn Elementary. It was mm-hmm. public school.
North Liberty?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Zach?
Like Gallagher said, I'm really thankful for this senior class. I wouldn't have wanted to do this with any other group of guys. These guys are like my brothers, my second family. And I guess I'm just going to miss them next year. Going to miss playing with you guys.
Yeah. It makes the reunions that much more
brothers down here.
they're a band of brothers. Well, Zach, you come from a really wonderful family, too. I know your mom and dad really well.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't know it, but we used to sit behind you at St. Mary's at Mass, and my son's always looking up to you and thinking you're the big shot. You used to serve Mass with him, in fact.
Yeah, I remember that.
He's still an altar boy. Bud, what are you thankful for?
Just being here with these guys. Yeah. I missed the trophy. I was going to touch it.
Okay, who was responsible for the trophy?
That would have been me.
Is it out in the car or anything like that?
No, it's actually in the athletic office.
This is the first year that's been left behind.
How do you forget that?
Coach Cook just told me yesterday, and I was trying to round up a group of guys to come talk. But
it's a different looking trophy this year, I noticed.
It's
a lot lighter.
Yeah, it's not as big.
But it's better looking, I think.
You scared me, guys, when you grabbed that trophy after the championship game. You guys were shaking it like this. And I was going, no, save it for the show.
I think the greatest thing you did is brought it over to the fans.
Yeah.
I've gone to all five of them. I haven't hardly missed a game, and you guys proved something after the Solon game that none of the other teams had to prove.
Yeah.
You proved a thing when you went to Xavier. I was never so happy in all my life.
I was just glad we didn't break it. Like 2 years ago, 2 years ago, Ron Osterhaus broke the punter off the side of the trophy.
We remember. It was here the next week in pieces. Bob, what are you thankful for?
Well, I'm thankful for the Regina community as a whole. It's been there since 1958 as Regina. And I'm thankful for the fact that these young men have really represented not only their teammates, but their school and their community with class. They've handled themselves very well. We've heard them interviewed many times on the radio, for example, and they've done a great job, and they've had great leadership in Marv and his group, and I think they have a lot to be proud of.
We have
beyond the football field.
And we've got no time left on this show, so we're going to have to say thanks to Zach and Luke and Michael from Regina. I will say that I'm thankful to the guys here on the show, to Joe Murphy behind us, for being here every week. I'm thankful to you guys and your teammates and your classmates for all the thrills and excitement you've given us over the last 4 years of high school. We wish you all the luck in the world in the future, and I think with the coaching staff behind you, you guys are going to accomplish even greater things in life. Keep it up. Don't forget us back here when you're big shots out there in the real world. And until then, good luck. On behalf of Bud Supel and Bob Boyd and Earl Murphy, I'm Dirk Keller, thanking you for watching Sports Opinion every Wednesday night on Public Access TV, Channel 18. And if you miss it there, you can go to PATV.tv, or you can go to my Facebook page and watch every episode of Sports Opinion, whatever you like. Until then, we want to wish you all a very happy, festive Thanksgiving, and we'll see you next week. Go Regals, go Hawks.
Amen.